All right, is there anything on the review that you would like me to go over? I will collect the review tomorrow because that'll be the day we do the quiz, but so I won't mark it off today. Questions off the review. Okay, here I go. Someone asked for 23, and I'm doing it. Once you guys settle down. Okay, number 23. That's 32. That's X. That's 96. Okay. So the first thing to realize is if we didn't have the small circle in here, you'd have an arc here of 96, and then you'd have an inscribed angle, which an inscribed angle to the outside always has to be half, right? Yeah. So this is double the size of what this angle is right here. Agree? Yeah. So what's half of 96? 48. Okay. Now let's ignore the big circle. We used it, got what we needed, and tossed it. I won't give you any analogies like that, but 64. Okay, let's see. So I'm gonna go here. So it's this, being it's inside. What do we do with those two angles?
96 minus 32 or 2.
No. X is it plus or minus?
Minus.
Why is it minus in this case? Right. This. So if we're using the smaller circle, that is outside, so it has to be minus. So I have x minus 32 over 2 is equal to 48. All right? So if I multiply both sides, x minus 32 equals 96. Add 32 to both sides, so 96 added to 32 is 128. Cool. Is that right?
Yeah.
That's what the answer said?
Mm-hmm.
There's no Y on it?
No.
Okay.
Wait, but then another 23.
This one's 28.
Okay.
Huh. Okay.
Couldn't you have done 96 plus 32?
It would have, I think it would have been a coincidence. Yeah. 2-2. All right, number 22. All right, so this, they tell us, is 39. This is 7x minus 2. And this is 17. X plus 6. So that angle's outside. So we have to go this minus this is equal to the, or this minus this divided by 2 equals 39. So 17x plus 6 minus 7x plus 2. Why did that become 7x? Negative 7x plus 2. Subtracting, right? Over 2 is equal to 39. Let's see, that's going to give me 10x. Plus 8, multiply both sides by 2, so that's 78. Yeah.
Wouldn't it be 7x minus
2? It was already 7x minus 2, so if I'm subtracting that, I'd have to. If I could talk, I would be a much better person today. It's actually. So this is what you're doing right here, right before. So then you distribute.
Okay.
Okay. Let's see, that's 10x is equal to 70, so x equals 7. Is that right?
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah.
19.
Bless you. Okay. So this is 129 right here. This is 35. And this is x. A couple of you talk a little too much, but we are reviewing. All right, so I would find this angle first. So that 129 have to add up to be 180. So 180 minus
40.
I'm with you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
All right. So being that these meet inside, I have to add them. So x plus 35 over 2 equals 51. X plus 35 is equal to 102. X equals 102 minus 35, whatever that comes out to.
Big number,
67. Is it? Cool.
2, 4?
Yeah.
I don't think that's right.
24 is going to be done similar to 23. We're doing concentric circles, so. So then this right here is 124, this right here is 167, this here's x.
Okay.
So I'd say something I'd go to find is the relationship from here to, actually the relationship from here to here is half. So this here angle has to be 62 degrees. So now we've used the big circle in order to get the answer there. So now if I use just the small circle, so I'm using just this, is all I'm worried about. Being that happens outside, I'm going to go big arc minus small arc divided by 2 equals 62 equals 124. Subtract 162 from 124. How much is it? No. Oh, it's 160. Thank you. Minus 167. Thank you. What is 124 minus 167? Negative 43. Negative 43. We have a negative x and a negative 43. That means x equals 43. Yeah.
15.
That they tell us that this is angle 1 right here. This is 41. This is 53. So I'm just going to put a question mark right there. Is that okay? Question marks can be my variable. So I know that because this happens inside, I go 41 plus 53 divided by 2, and that's going to give me question mark. So that's going to be, what, 94 over 2 equals question mark. What's half of 94? 47. So this is 47 degrees. That means that these two angles have to add up to 180. So 43? Is that right? Yep. Oh, wait. No, 143, right?
133.
133 degrees, yeah. Because 133 plus 47 is 180. Thank you. Anything else from the review? You?
Number four.
wait. Cheese. Look at the wrong one. I'm sorry. Or you just get dim and then go bright again.
Devin?
Devin, no, I don't want to do that in that class.
Here is the radius of they tell us this is 84. They tell us, okay, I'm going to label this right. So I have M, N, J, K, center P, L. N to K, all right, I'm just going to start labeling things that I know just because of the graph. All right, this triangle is inscribed, so if it's an inscribed triangle, that means it has to form a 90 degree angle there. Okay, I don't know if that's going to help us or not. Do I have any other inscribed triangles that I'm looking at? Nope, not all 3 points are on there. So that's the first thing I need to know. So, if this is 84, if I look right here, at this arc here to here, goes out to 84, so that's an inscribed angle, so that has to be half of that. So that has to be 42 right there. Being the whole thing was 90, that means that this would have to be 48 right here. I don't know if these are any things that I need yet. I'm just going off of what I see. This whole angle here has to be half of the 116. Half of 116 is 58. Is that okay so far?
Eight.
All right. Anything else I can go to?
Angle N is
42. Oh, you're good. Yep, inscribed angle right here. So that's 42 right there. Okay. Because it's this inscribed angle here to that 84.
Okay.
M, angle M, here we go, this is going to start working. It goes from here to here. So that's got to be half of 116 as well. So that's 58. If that's 58 and 42, 58 added to 42 is 60, 100. This is 80. If that's 80, this has to be 80. This would have to be 100. This would have to be 100, linear pair. Does that help me at all? Because this angle here, is this inscribed arc? All right. Oh, Oh, so now I can figure out this angle here, because this goes to this arc, and this goes to, nope. That's not going to work. So I can't do that. Oh, okay. So this is a semicircle here. So if this is 1/16 over here, this distance here has to be not 1/16, has to add up to 180. So that would be
64.
Yep. Cool.
Look at that math.
I love it. And then if then I can get this to be 32 here. If that's 32 there, I add that to 48 because this opens onto that arc at 64. So
wait,
I thought the whole blue was 1/16.
Oh shoot, you're right. Okay. Thank you for not letting me go too far. So we can't do that 64, right? Okay, there's gotta be another way we can get there. Shoot. I could find this arc length here, right?
Yeah.
What?
Can I put 100 at like the NL, like that, there next to the 80? You got corresponding angle up to the
J. Say that one more time, I'm sorry.
N and M, there was like the 80 on the bottom, 80 on the bottom, like top.
Here?
Yeah, there, and then the 100, right next to it. Can you move it up to the, to be on top of the next 80 to be corresponding angle?
Here? I don't know if I have parallel lines. Where yet?
The angle
K.
Yeah, right there.
So that's going to give me that this to be the 96, but doesn't really help me yet. Where else should we go on this puppy? Can't get that last angle yet. Is there? No? Anybody else see anything else? I don't even know what we're supposed to find on this. So JKL, we have that whole angle is 90, we got that. MKL, we have is 42, we got that. KMN, we have is 58, it's right there. JKM, we have is 48 up there. KLN, we have is 58 right there. LNM, we have is 42, it's there. Arc M to J, we have is 96. And arc LKG, LKJ, oh. So LKJ all the way to here, that's the 180. And we have everything listed now. I wanted to solve more about that, but hey,
that's
we got it. That's a good problem. I like that problem. Any others from the homework? All right. So that will be collected tomorrow. Johnny, that is an inscribed angle. So 9x plus 21 equals 5x divided by 2. Or no, take 9x plus 21 divided by 2 equals 5x. So then you get 9x plus 21 equals 10x, and then solve that.
So when are you supposed to add them instead of subtracting?
When it's inside, if the angle's happening inside.
Like when it's like that?
Yes.
Or, what would you be solving?
Oh, no. You're adding here.
You're adding this arc. It's not on that one you're going to be adding them. It's going to be the...
That thing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. I will not... If you have something to pat or bring up to me, that's awesome. We will turn the review in tomorrow.
If you at... Do you have 9-6?
Yeah.
9-6, put it right there on that desk.
Sick. Y'all
take 9-6 goes on this desk. Make sure your name's on it, please.
It is. Is that directly towards me, Mr. Strait? That name thing?
Yes, sir.
What's your comment?
Yeah.
Too many?
No.
Got it. Perfect. You can go on that desk before.
I've been to...
All right, so does anybody have any more of the 9-6s, or are they all over there?
They're all over there.
Put them over there on that desk if you get them. Please.
You.
Huh?
We got one.
We're good?
There you go.
It's because I'm picking on Zach these days. I'm sorry. I don't mean to bully you, man. All right. So this stuff will not be on the quiz. This will be stuff for later. Segment lengths within circles. Develop understanding of the properties for the segment lengths associated with circles and apply that understanding to the missing measures. Yay! We good so far? All right.
What does that do for me?
Oh. Okay. So, we have proven that finding the angle measures for the angles formed by chords of a circle. Okay. Do you think we can also find the relationship exists for the four segments? And formed by the intersection of the chords. So, we're gonna start showing that this segment length relationship and this has a relationship here and here. Okay? So we've already taken care of the angles in the relationship. And if the chords happen inside, you add them, divide by two. And but now we're gonna work with what happens when we have the segment lengths. Okay? Can I move on?
Let's see. Now, why do I grab here?
Okay, that's great. I can move that. Yay. I'm not quite sure what this benefit for me, but there it is. Let's just go to the theorem. All right.
Let's get rid of all the stuff I don't want. My goodness. How much?
Okay. Everything there now? Okay. All right, theorem 9. If two chords intersect in a circle, then the product of the lengths of the segments of one chord is equal to the product of the lengths of the other. So that would show you that x times y, or x times your w, so this segment here times this segment here, which are on the same line, are equal to this segment times this segment. Is that all it's saying? There's not a whole lot of words you really need to worry about writing. I think we could have just gone off the diagram. I think. Are we good so far? That's not a lot of work just for theorem.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, we gotta put the little dot, the blank dots in. It's really just this right here is everything. This doesn't help you as much as that.
Okay.
Cool. All right. So find the value of x. So I have this segment here being x plus 1. Agree? And if I go x plus 1 times 3x, that's going to be equal to x times 4x. So we got to be cautious on some of these if we're going to be using algebra, especially if we start getting things that are squared. If we plug our value back in and it gives us a negative term, that can't happen. That's called an extraneous solution, but we'll take care of that later. So I get 3x squared plus 3x equals 4x squared. Everyone agree there? I'm going to subtract 3x squared. So 3x squared is, or 3x is equal to x squared. So I guess you can move that over as well. So we're going to have x squared minus 3x is equal to 0. How do you start solving this? What do I have in common between these two?
X.
So I have a GCF of x. So I get x minus 3. X and x minus 3 set them equal to 0. So x is equal to 0. Am I going to have a negative or a 0 length?
No.
So that's an extraneous solution. And then x minus 3 equals 0. So x equals 3. So my answer to this problem is 3. Yeah.
So how do you know that? Like, how do you know that they, like, the products will be equal? Because, like, and
theorem?
I mean, yeah, but I mean, with the chords, like, how do you know that they're placed in the same way that
it's just any two chords. It doesn't matter what two chords. If you have two chords that intersect, the part times the part of the one is equal to the part times the part of the other every time.
Okay.
Okay? All right. We good here? All right. Ooh, we have something fancy. This might explain why that works. Okay. What about the segments formed by a secant and a tangent? Remember, secant goes through a circle and goes outside of it. Tangent touches the circle once. What triangles can we consider? So I just drew that extra thing of triangles in there. So I have triangle with angle 1 and angle 2. What are some things that you know about this angle? Let's see. That's tangent. So if I had the radius, that would form a 90. I don't have enough for a 90 at that point. But it looks like... That looks like we start taking those triangles apart. We have three triangles. We have the big, and then we have the two small ones. We have to start setting them. They're probably similar to each other. Okay, so. No. Goodness. Come on, just be a couple. No, more. There's a whole bunch of stuff here, and here, and here. There we got. So theorem 9.5, if secant and tangent share a common endpoint outside of the circle, then the product of the external secant and the entire secant is equal to the square of the tangent.
There it is. That's what I want.
So if I take the tangent and square it, it's equal to the length of the external times this whole length of the secant. Okay? So it's this squared equals this plus the whole value, times the whole value. And I bet you, so I think this right here is the most helpful portion to that. I would think. I don't think the words are going to help you because I'm not going to. If you see that product right there, you should be good. Can I move on?
Yeah.
All right, so with that known, that would mean that 24 squared is equal to 16 times x plus 16. So the square of the tangent equals the exterior of the secant times the whole secant. The whole secant would be x plus 16. So 24 squared is 576, I believe. And I get 16x plus 16 times 16 is 256? No? Yes? Am I right? Man, I got lucky. Subtract 256. Somebody double check my math. So that's 320 equals 16x. So x is equal to 20. Well, that worked out well, because 320 divided by 16 is 20. You doing okay?
Yeah. No.
Am I in the back yet? All right, can I move on?
Yeah.
Everyone feel okay? Yeah. All right, uh-oh, another gym day I need to bring up. Okay, finally, consider the segments formed by two secant segments from an outside point. What triangles can we form? So again, we're going to have those triangles that are going to form in place. I think that's the most important part to think about. Then we're going to Theorem 9.16. Guess what? I get to remove.
Oh, there's so many.
Dude.
I'm more of a visual learner.
Alright, Theorem 9.16. What is this 9.16? If two secant segments share the same endpoint outside the circle, then the product of the external segment and the entire segment of one secant is equal to the product of the external segment and the entire segment of the other. In terms that you guys might appreciate, circle, still with me? Secant, another secant, still with me?
Yep.
External part, an external part.
Wow.
Entire, and ooh, do I have a color I haven't used yet?
Yellow. Maroon.
Oh. Oh. Dotted. What the?
Yeah. So, see if you can figure out my thing. This times this, right? The external times the whole is equal to black times blue. Can you decipher the stirrupism?
So
part times the whole equals part times the whole. The external part times the whole times is equal to the external part times the whole. So this would have been so much better done on this one. This means y times y plus z. Why am I saying it's y plus z? That's the entire distance. Is equal to w times what? W plus x. That's what we're doing. That's for external secants. It's very similar. The tangent one is just the square of the tangent.
Oh.
Okay. So the tangent one was if I had this, it's this value, and then the y and z. So x squared equals y times y plus z. Whereas that one just has two secants. So it has to be external to the whole is equal to external to the whole. Yay? Can I move on? All right, so 3 times 3 plus x. Why is it 3 plus x, not just x? Because the whole length of that chord, or that secant, is 3 plus x. Is equal to 4 times 4 plus 2. So that's going to give me 9 plus 3x is equal to, that's 6, 24. Did I do that right?
Yeah.
Okay? So 3x is equal to, subtract 9 from both sides, that becomes 15. So x is equal to 5. Woo!
Waiting. Wow.
Doing all right? Ready for the last four? Should I go real fast?
Yeah.
No way! Here we go. All right. X squared equals 1 times 1 plus 3, yes? So x squared is equal to 4. X is equal to the plus or minus value of the square root of 4, which x is equal to plus or minus 2. Which value do I not pay attention to?
The
negative. That's so I'm not going to have a negative length. That's my answer. One day you guys can deal with negative lengths, and it'd be so much fun.
What is it? Is it like a, paradox?
A pair of docs. Yeah, there's two doctors. There's. All right, moving on. Yes, no? All right, here we go. 7 squared is equal to 5 times what? 5 plus x, thank you. So that's 49 equals 25 plus 5x.
Minus
25. So that's 24.
Equals 5 doesn't work.
It doesn't?
It's a weird number.
24 fifths. I like it.
Good job.
4.8. Sweet. Dude, I totally get this stuff.
No way.
Way. It for a change. Other times I'm like totally lost. Other times I'm totally winging the stuff. I have no idea where I'm going.
It's just
it is.
On the spot. It's like a class.
Everything you've learned is just habitually wrong in this class.
Yeah.
How awesome is that, huh?
What do you mean does it mean nothing?
You know, when we add fractions, we don't need common denominators. We just add top to top, bottom to bottom.
Oh, yeah,
it's all good.
The Pythagorean theorem doesn't exist. That's something you just like.
Yep.
You saw like a python earlier that day, and you're just like, yeah.
You got that right. All right, ready? So this is going to be 3 times x plus 5. Why did I get that? Yeah, I added 3 and the 2. Is equal to x plus 1 times x plus 1 plus x minus 1. So that's 3x plus 15 is equal to x plus 1. Uh-oh, what happens in here? I have minus 1 plus 1. Those are gone. X plus x, that's 2x, right? Because that was x plus 1, x minus 1, right?
Yeah.
So the 1's are gone. And so I get 3x plus 15 is equal to 2x squared plus 2x, right?
Yeah.
Let's get everything on the same side. So I'm going to get 2x squared.
Oh.
Move that over, so I get minus x. Move that over, I get minus 15. Anybody good at factoring?
Yeah.
So I went 2x times that, 2x squared, 2x times 1 is that. So if I move, so if I have this, here it is. Is that right? If I minus that, I get that.
It's 2 and then x minus 3 and then x plus 5. Right?
So how do you
wait,
2
no.
Wait, yes, yes, that does work. X minus 3 and then x plus 5. Because then that lets. No, wait, why doesn't it work?
That's negative 30 is our magic number, so you have alternating signs.
I know, I get that. Because
okay.
Then I got x minus 6, x plus 5, but then getting that 2, I don't know. That's what I did. And then I did 2.
Is that factored right so far?
Yeah.
I have a common. I have a 2x. That's x minus 3. Factor out of 5.
Just kidding.
X minus 3. So
x equals 3.
So I get 2x plus 5 equals 0. And x minus 3 equals 0. Which one do I eliminate?
2x plus 5.
Yeah, this gives me a negative length, right? And if I plug that negative length back in, especially there, it's going to be negative. That's extraneous. So x is equal to 3. If you have trouble with factoring by grouping, come see me. I can teach you pretty well. Yeah.
So you got the 6 and the
-6x and 5x from -30.
Yes. Because the factors of 30 are 1 and 32 and 15, 5 and 6, which one has to be positive, one has to be negative to add to negative 1. And that'd be 5 and 6 with the negative 6 being negative.
Okay. And then, okay.
All right. Isn't that how Richardson taught it? Did I do it the same way he did, Mr. Richardson? Factoring? Just say yes. Please. All right. Find all values of x. All right, ready? X times 3 is 3x. 4 times 6 is 24. X equals 8 on this one. Agreed? This one's going to be x times x plus 29 equals 18 times 40. Where'd the 40 come from? 18 plus 22, good. So I get x squared plus 29x equals, what's 18 times 40? Help me out. Is it really? Really? Thanks, buddy. So x squared plus 29x minus 720 equals 0. Anyone want to take a shot at the factors of that? All right, so I know I'm going to get x plus, and I'm going to get x minus. And I need the factors of 720, one being positive, one being negative, that add to 29. So 1 and 720, 2 and 360. Let's go to 10 and 72. No.
4 and 180.
10 and 72. 36 and 20. Nope, too far. 14. What is it? 15 times what gives me 720? You guys have the calculators. 720 divided by 15 is?
48.
Is it? 15 and 48, does that work? 15 and 48?
No, that's
38. 15 and 48 won't work. 720 divided by 16 is?
45.
16 and 45? Still off a little bit?
No, that's
it? Oh, sweet. So it's got to be the x squared plus 45x minus 16x minus 720. X comes out of those first two, leave me x plus 45. X plus 45 won't work. And then factor out a minus 16, that gives me x plus 45. So x minus 16. So x has to be 16. The other one gives me a negative answer. Oh, sweet. Gotta love the day of factoring, huh? Any more? Oh, all right. Oh. Wait a minute, what is that? What? No, it can't be a test. It's not the test. That's an old note. Hang on. Hang on. So we're going to do the quiz tomorrow on 9-4 to 9-6. You're totally ready for it. It's not this old stuff. And then on Friday, we're going to lecture on 9-6. And then the test is going to be after spring break. We'll make it the Monday after spring break because you'll all be prepared by then.